Very good morning, students. Our today's general knowledge topic is inventions and discoveries. The first invention is by Christopher Columbus of America. Christopher Columbus was an Italian explorer who stumbled upon the Americas and whose journeys marked the beginning of centuries of transatlantic colonization. Age of discovery. During the 15th and 16th centuries, leaders of several European nations sponsored expeditions abroad in the hope that explorers would find great wealth and vast undiscovered lands. The Portuguese were the earliest participants in this age of discovery, also known as age of exploration. Starting in about 1420, small Portuguese ships known as caravels zipped along the African coast, carrying spices, gold, slaves, and other goods from Asia and Africa to Europe. Did you know that Christopher Columbus was not the first person to propose that a person could reach Asia by sailing west from Europe? In fact, scholars argue that the idea is almost as old as the idea that the earth is round, and that is the dates back to the early Rome. Other European nations, particularly Spain, were eager to share in the seemingly limitless richness of the Far East. By the end of the 15th century, Spain's Reconquista, the expulsion of Jews and Muslims out of the kingdom after centuries of war, was complete, and the nation turned its attention to exploration and conquest in other areas of the world. Early life of Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus, the son of a wool merchant, is believed to have been born in Genoa in Italy in the year 1451. When he was still a teenager, he got a job on a merchant ship. He remained at sea until 1476. When pirates attacked his ship as it sailed north along the Portuguese coast, the boat sank. But the young Columbus floated to shore on a scrap of wood and made his way to Lisbon, where he eventually studied mathematics, astronomy, cartography, and navigation. He also began to hatch the plan that would change the world forever. The first voyage by the Christopher Columbus. At the end of the 15th century, it was nearly impossible to reach Asia from Europe by land. The route was long, and encounters with hostile armies were difficult to avoid. Portuguese explorers solved this problem by taking to the sea. They sailed the south along the West African coast and around the Cape of Good Hope. But Columbus had a different idea. Why not sail west across the Atlantic instead of around the massive African continent? The young navigator's logic was sound, but his math was faulty. He argued incorrectly that the circumference of the earth was much smaller than his contemporaries believed it was. Accordingly, he believed that the journey by boat from Europe to Asia should be not only possible but comparatively easy via an as yet undiscovered Northwest Passage. He presented his plan to officials in Portugal and England, but he was not until 1492 that he found a sympathetic audience. The Spanish monarchs The Columbus wanted fame and fortune, but the Ferdinand and Isabella wanted the same. Along with the opportunity to export the Catholicism to lands across the globe, enthusiastic Columbus, as a devout Catholic, was equally enthusiastic about this possibility. Columbus' contract with the Spanish rulers promised that he could keep 10% of whatever riches he found, along with a noble title and the governorship of any lands he should encounter. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we have discussed about the greatest discovery by the Christopher Columbus of the American continent. Now, the second discovery is by the Robert Peary of North Pole. Robert Edwin Peary was an American explorer who claimed to have first reached the geographic North Pole in the year 1909. He is one of the highly acclaimed dog team and sledge polar explorers to make considerable efforts for understanding the Inuit's culture and Arctic Circle. Early on in his career, the desire to go on long expeditions always triggered his explorations. The adverse weather conditions and several health issues did not deter him, and his strong will to reach the North Pole kept him going. Despite facing credibility issues, he has been widely acclaimed and appreciated for his discovery of the world's three largest meteorites. He was honored with numerous awards and accolades, but his North Pole expedition of 1909 is still disputed. Robert Peary's early life. As Robert Peary was born on 6th May 1856 in Pennsylvania, he enrolled for civil engineering from Bowdoin College in 1873, from which he graduated in 1877. Robert Peary also served as the U.S. Coast and Geodetic Survey in Washington, D.C. as a draftsman making technical drawings. While still very young, he aspired to make long expeditions, for which his preparations began quite timely in the form of 25-mile hikes he made every week. His intellect helped him clear the examinations of the U.S. Navy too. He started by joining the U.S. Navy Civil Engineer Corps in 1888 as a civil engineer. Career of Robert Peary. As Robert Peary's career began in the year 1884 as a chief assistant on an expedition in which he worked on surveying a ship canal. It was during his period only that his inclination towards the North Pole expedition or the exploration increased. In the year 1886, the paper that he wrote for the National Academy of Sciences, he mentioned about two ways for crossing the Greenland's ice cap. The further expeditions to higher latitudes required a ship and huge funds, which Peary arranged by delivering lectures at various places. The awards and achievements of the Robert Peary's. The post-retirement, Peary won many accolades from various scientific societies in Europe and America for his expedition to the North Pole. The origin of Naval Reserve during the First World War and the US Postal Service's airmail system based on the airmail routes are also credited to Peary. Robert Peary's expedition to the North Pole got him a Congressional Medal in the year 1944. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we have discussed about few of the inventions and discoveries. In this video, we are going to discuss about the one more discovery by the Nicolaus Copernicus of the solar system. Nicolaus Copernicus was a Polish astronomer known as the father of modern astronomy. He was the first modern European scientist to propose the Earth and the other planets revolved around the Sun, or the heliocentric theory of the universe. Prior to the publication of his major astronomical work, 6 books concerning the revolutions of the heavenly orbs in the year 1543, the European astronomers argued that Earth lay at the center of the universe, the view also held by most ancient philosophers and biblical writers. In addition to correctly postulating the order of the known planets, including Earth from the Sun, and estimating their orbital periods relatively accurately, the Copernicus argued that the Earth turned daily on its axis and that gradual shift of this axis accounted for the changing seasons. The heliocentric theory by the Nicolaus Copernicus. Sometime between 1508 and 1514, Nicolaus Copernicus wrote a short astronomical treatise commonly called the Little Commentary, which laid the basis for his heliocentric, Sun is at the center, system, and the work was not published in his lifetime. In the treatise, he correctly postulated the order of the known planets, including Earth, from the Sun, and estimated their orbital periods relatively accurately. For Copernicus, his heliocentric theory was by no means a watershed, for it created as many problems as it solved. For instance, the heavy objects were always assumed to fall to the ground because Earth was the center of the universe. Why would they do so in a sun-centered system? He retained the ancient belief that circles govern the heavens, but his evidence showed that even in a sun-centered universe, the planets and stars did not revolve around the sun in circular orbits. Because of these problems and others, the Copernicus delayed publication of his major astronomical work. Concerning his 6 books, The Revolutions of the Heavenly Orbs, nearly all his life, completed around the year 1530, and it was not published until the year 1543, the year of his death. Very good morning, students. Here we are going to discuss about the another invention and the discovery by Tabby Junko of the Everest. Junko Tabby was a Japanese mountaineer who became the first woman to reach the summit of Mount Everest, the world's highest mountain. Throughout her life, she challenged cultural norms relating to gender in Japan, and she climbed to the top of mountains in 76 different countries. "Do not give up," Tabby said. "Keep on your quest." Tabby is honored by a Google Doodle on September 22, 2019. on what would have been her 80th birthday. She died in the year 2016. The story of Tabby's journey to reach the top of Everest matches her life's journey. Both were remarkable tables of perseverance in the face of great challenges. In fact, she crawled part of the way up Everest after almost being killed in an avalanche. And that was just for starters. According to NPR, she later became the first woman to conquer the 7 summits, which means she reached the summit of the tallest mountain peak on every single continent on Earth. Among those, Africa's Mount Kilimanjaro and Alaska's Mount Denali. She did this while facing gender discrimination in a country where women were often expected to stay at home in that era. Final ascent was a step-by-step struggle, but when I arrived, I didn't have an overwhelming sense of achievement. It was more like relief. I couldn't believe the climb was finally over and I had go down instead of up. I have to go down instead of up. She recalled of scaling Everest. According to Japan Times, the precious thing about that moment was beyond being the first woman there. The summit of Everest was utterly beautiful, without a single man-made object in sight. Very good morning, students. In our earlier videos, we have discussed about some of the geographical discoveries and inventions. In this video, we are going to discuss about few of the inventions and discoveries in the field of physics and chemistry. The first invention here it is law of gravitation by Newton. Gravitation, or just gravity, is the force of attraction between any two bodies. All the objects in the universe attract each other with a certain amount of force. But in most of the cases, the force is too weak to be observed due to very large distance of separation. Besides, gravity's range is infinite, but the effect becomes weaker as objects move away. That is why this force of attraction was first observed by Sir Isaac Newton and was presented as Newton's law of gravitation in the year 1680. However, gravitation can generally exist in two main instances. The first one is gravitation may be the attraction of objects by Earth. For example, if a body in the form of ball is thrown upwards, it reaches a certain height and falls downwards because of the gravity of the Earth. Secondly, gravitation may be the attraction of objects in outer space. For example, force of attraction between the other planets and Sun. What is a gravitational force? Each body in this universe attracts other bodies towards itself with a force known as gravitational force. And thus, gravitation is a study of the interaction between two masses. Out of the two masses, the heavier one is called source mass and the lighter one is called test mass. Gravitational force is a central force which depends only on the position of test mass from the source mass and always acts along the line joining the centers of the two masses. The core problem of gravitation has always been in understanding the interaction between the two masses and the relativistic effects associated with it. History of gravitational theory. Ptolemy has proposed geocentric model which failed in understanding planetary motions led to the development of the heliocentric model by Nicolaus Copernicus, whose idea is based on the rotation of a test mass around the source mass in circular orbits. Although the model correctly predicts the position of planets and their motions, but has failed in explaining many aspects like the occurrence of seasons, which led to the construction of a model based on Kepler's laws of planetary motions. By this Newton's law of gravitation, according to him, the law of gravitation in which every particle in the universe attracts every other particle with a force whose magnitude is directly proportional to the product of their masses or inversely proportional to the square of the distance between their center. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we have discussed about the law of gravitation by Sir Isaac Newton, invention and discovery in the field of physics and chemistry. Now, in this video, we are going to discuss about one more invention and discovery by Einstein. The name of the invention is theory of relativity. Among the outstanding advances in science will always stand Albert Einstein's theory of relativity. The problem of how physical laws and measurements change when considered by observers in various states of motion. This theory's force revision of all fundamental thinking about time and space. They brought changes in many statements of natural law, including Isaac Newton's law of gravitation. And the theories gave scientists the mathematical framework they needed for atomic research and for releasing nuclear energy. Einstein came up with his first theory of relativity, called the theory of spatial relativity, in the year 1905. It revealed that no material object can ever travel as fast as light, which has a constant speed for all observers, no matter their motion. The speed of light is thus the speed limit of the universe. Spatial relativity also showed that mass and energy are the same physical entity and can be changed into each other. Einstein conceived his second relativity theory, called the theory of general relativity. In the year 1916, this theory concerns gravity, one of the fundamental forces in the universe. Gravitation is a very weak force. For this reason, its distinctive effects are evident only on very massive objects. The theory of general relativity thus describes such large-scale physical phenomena as the movement of planets, the birth and the death of stars, black holes, and the evolution of the universe. At first, it was said that only a dozen people in the world could understand these revolutionary theories. This was only partially correct. It is true that the relativity theories employ the highest branches of mathematics, but today thousands of scientists understand the theories, and anyone can get a good idea of relativity by thinking the matter through. Einstein's thinking grew out of a number of scientific puzzles, especially about light. For many years, scientists had believed that light traveled across space as waves in an elastic, weightless, and invisible medium called the luminiferous either. They thought Earth moved or drifted through the ether. But no sign of motion appeared. If light was carried by an ether, Earth seemed to be standing still in it. Of all the attempts made to explain this result, the most promising was offered by the Dutch physicist. He suggested that matter moving through the ether might become slightly shortened in the direction of motion. If this affected the instrument by just the right amount, it would nullify the experiment. So the very suggestions raised doubt about the certainty of any scientific measurement, and many efforts were made to detect such a contraction. But none succeeded. So scientists were left with this haunting doubts about the accuracy of all measurements until Einstein offered his theory of spatial relativity as an answer. Very good morning, students. In our previous video, we have discussed about few of the inventions and discoveries in physics and chemistry. In this video, we are going to discuss about Darwin's contribution in the theory of evolution. Charles Darwin, an English naturalist of the 19th century, made an extensive study of nature for over 20 years. He collected the observations on animal distribution and the relationship between the living and extinct animals, and finally found that the present living animals share similarities to some extent, not only between them but also with the other species that existed millions of years ago, and among which some have become extinct. Charles Darwin is also known as the father of evolution due to his contribution to the establishment of the theory of evolution. His theory helped in removing all the conventional old beliefs, which said to be the formation of various species was a supernatural phenomenon or act of the Almighty. Darwin's evolutionary theory of natural selection gave a more rational explanation of the formation of new species. As per natural selection, various species originated from a single species as a result of adaptation to the changing environment. Theory of evolution. Darwin had the following ideas regarding the theory of natural selection. Species kept on evolving or changing with time. As the environment changes, the requirement of an organism also change and they adapt to the new environment. This phenomenon of changing over a period of time as per the natural requirements is called adaptation. As per Darwin's theory, only the superior changes are naturally selected and the inferior ones are eliminated. Thus, not all adaptations contribute to progressive evolution. For example, people living in tropical countries have more melanin in their body to protect them from the sunlight. Almost all organisms share common ancestry with some organisms. According to Darwin, all organisms had one common ancestor at some point in time and kept on diverging ever since. His evolutionary theories support the convergent theory and divergent theory of evolution with examples. He also studied that the birds of Galapagos Islands develop different beaks as per the availability of the food. This proved adaptive radiation Similarly, he also observed the Australian birds, which showed a number of emerging species from an ancestor. According to the Charles Darwin, evolution is a very slow and gradual process. He concluded that evolution took place over a very long period of time. As we talk about the time period in evolution, we usually refer to billions of years. The generation of a species from another takes a long period of time. It is a very steady process, as the changes and adaptation take a long time to stabilize and give rise to a new species.